Welcome to this time of worship here at Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. I'm glad you could join us. My name is Chuck Schneider. I'm one of the pastors here at Emmanuel. Before we begin worship this day, I'd like to remind you that the office remains closed to the public during this time. However, you can reach Margaret or Christine using the office phone number during normal business hours or by email. I'd also like to remind you that you can send prayer requests to prayer@emmanuelpc.org, and they'll be sent to both me and to the prayer circle as we hold you and our community and our world in prayer throughout the week and then here on Sunday mornings. We will be meeting for a time of virtual fellowship at 11 o'clock each Sunday morning. You'll find details on our website, or our Facebook page, and in the email messages that come out periodically through the week from the office. Next week, Sunday, May 3rd, we'll be taking up the Brady Ellis Special Offering. And this offering makes possible a gift to graduating high school seniors as they continue your education. I invite you to prayerfully consider this offering and to give generously. And now, I invite you to set aside those things that distract you, that keep you from coming fully into God's presence, and prepare your hearts to worship the Lord our God.
Let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified.
As the sun set over the village of Emmaus, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his friends. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. Today we gather around table, font and pulpit, hoping, trusting to behold the risen Lord. May our eyes be opened to recognize Jesus in our midst.
Thank you. us for our opening prayer.
Living God, we long to walk the roads of our lives with you. Come alongside this day as we gather for worship.
Warm us with your presence. Teach us your wisdom. Set our hearts burning within us as with your Holy Spirit. Amen.
This we know. Jesus, who was crucified, is both Messiah and Lord. In this season of Easter, let us turn from ways that lead to death and live as people of the resurrection. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Living Lord, by the power of your Spirit, you are present among us. Yet like the first disciples, we fail to see you in our midst. We do not realize that you are walking beside us, for we are rushing to meet the demands of hectic schedules and overcrowded lives. We do not notice you in everyday encounters, for we are distracted by daily labors and consumed by our own concerns. We do not recognize you on our streets or at our tables, for our expectations are too limited to imagine all the ways you dwell among us. Open our eyes to perceive you in our midst, so that, seeing you clearly, we might follow you faithfully. Please take a few moments for your own silent prayers of confession. Please join me in the declaration of forgiveness. In the waters of our baptism, our sins are forgiven. In these waters, the Spirit claims us for good. This promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord God, our God, calls. Family of God, rejoice! For in these waters, we are raised to new life. Thanks be to God.
Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appeared the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Now, let's see. There's Jerusalem over there, and over there's Emmaus. And now that doesn't look like 7 miles to me.
Hey, Ralphie, what's with the map? It sure doesn't look like Texas.
Hi, Minnie. Well, it isn't Texas. This is a map of the Holy Land during Jesus' time. And I was just trying to figure out on the map where Emmaus was and how far it was from Jerusalem. It doesn't look too far, but I guess if you have to walk all that way, it would seem pretty far.
You're right. I know this story, Ralphie. It's all about when Jesus appeared to two people that were walking to Emmaus from Jerusalem, discussing what happened to Jesus at Easter.
Wow, that's right, Minnie, exactly. And the interesting thing to me about this story is when Jesus did appear to them and talk to them, they didn't recognize him.
That's right, Ralphie.
And I bet I know why they didn't recognize him, Minnie. Because he wore a disguise, just like they do in those spy movies. Maybe he wore a wig, or put on a fake nose and a trench coat.
Really? You never cease to amaze me. But let's continue with the story. When Jesus spoke to them, he asked them what was going on. And they told Jesus about everything that had happened, how Jesus was crucified, and then 3 days later, his tomb was empty, and the angels appeared to some women and said that he had risen.
Wow, what happened then, Minnie?
Well, they got to Emmaus, they invited Jesus to stay with them, and when they sat down for dinner, he took bread, broke it, and blessed it. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him.
Whoa.
And then he vanished.
Minnie, that's amazing. But how is that story relevant to us today and what we're all going through?
Well, Ralphie, I think Jesus comes to us in different forms all the time. In people, like the nurses and doctors and first responders helping all of those who are sick with the coronavirus. And the people helping to buy groceries for the elderly and volunteering at food banks. Even those who are still working at the grocery stores to make sure that we are all fed. Those are just some of the ways Jesus is showing himself to us.
That's really cool, Minnie. Just like Jesus took care of his people back during a walk to Emmaus.
That's right, Ralphie. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for all the ways you show us yourself to us, especially for all the ways we know you through Jesus. Help us remember that even during these trying times, you are with us. Goodbye.
Amen.
Bye-bye.
See you next time.
Our first scripture reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 14a, and then we will skip from 36 to 41. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? Peter said to them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added.
Our second reading comes to us this day from the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter, beginning at the 13th verse. Listen for the word of God to you this day. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And talking with each other about all the things that had happened, while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, What are you discussing with each other while you walk along? And they stood still, looking sad. And then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days? And he asked them, What things? And they replied, The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. And moreover, some women from our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. And some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. And then he said to them, Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? And then, beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he had interpreted to them all the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at a table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us? That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their companions gathered there together. They were saying, The Lord is risen. He has appeared to Simon. And then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of our Lord. For most of my life, the afternoon of Easter Sunday has been a time to step back and breathe, a quiet time to recover a bit from the excitement of the morning. This year, that seemed like a dim memory as we sheltered in place. There was no sunrise service, and the choir didn't blow the rafters off the sanctuary with their anthem or with the Alleluia chorus. We didn't dress up for church or for a special Easter morning brunch. Even the dough for the orange rolls that I was going to make that day failed to rise, and I had to throw it away twice. No, this Easter was different. As I read the scripture for this week, I realized that maybe that's not such a bad thing. You see, today's story about two of Jesus' followers walking the road to Emmaus takes place on the afternoon of that first Easter Sunday. And none of the things that I often associate with Easter celebrations are a part of their story either. You see, these folks have lived the crucifixion. the brutal death of Jesus. They rushed burial before sunset as Sabbath began on Friday evening, and the long wait for Sunday morning so that they could reclaim his body for a proper burial. As the sun rises, they discover that the funeral home has lost his body. The women who went to the tomb were saying that angels told them that Jesus had been raised and would meet up with them in Galilee. But this is just too much to believe, too much to hope for, and too much to bear. So these two left Jerusalem dispirited, heading home. Deep in thought and discussion, they didn't notice a stranger was walking with them for quite some time, until he asked what they were discussing. His voice surprised them, and his question amazed them. How could anyone not know of all the things that happened to Jesus over these last few days? It was the talk of Jerusalem. Everyone knew about it. As they walked, the stranger not only entered into the conversation, he seemed to take the lead. Answering their questions, he explained how all the things that had taken place fit Scripture, the words of the prophets. The inexplicable things that they had experienced had to happen the way they did. They had to have taken place just as they did. As evening approached, and they neared the turnoff to Emmaus, the stranger began to walk on, but the two invited him to stay at their home instead, hoping to continue their conversation, trying to make sense out of what only hours before had made no sense at all. And there, in the quiet of their home, the stranger took the lead, just as he had along the road. He took the bread. He blessed it and broke it, and he gave it to them. And in this moment, in his words and in his actions, they recognized Jesus. And as they do, he disappears. I wonder, have you ever felt like your world was turned upside down, your hopes and dreams dashed in an instant? Have you ever believed that you had life all figured out, your plans firmly established, your eyes set on the future, only to realize that it wouldn't happen according to your plans? Have you ever assumed you knew for absolute certain what God wanted of you and for you, what God's plans were for you, or that you had finally figured out who God is and how God is, and how all of this fits together? Have you ever asked yourself, is everything you believe a lie? Have you ever wondered where God is in the midst of the challenges, the most difficult moments of your life? If you've asked any of these questions or wondered any of these things, you know something of what Jesus' followers were feeling on that first Easter afternoon. And let me tell you, you're not alone. Their story is your story, and it's mine too. When I was in seminary, we considered questions like these, asking where God is in the midst of the most challenging moments of life. We were asked to think carefully and critically about how we might answer these questions for ourselves, because someday one of you would ask us just such a question. And one evening, a former student who was now a pastor of a congregation not far away came to share her experience with us. And she talked for some time about these questions, first in the abstract and then quite personally. And she asked us to close her eyes as she began to tell her story. Her son had been depressed for some time, but she thought he was making progress. And one night he called and told her that he couldn't take it any longer. He said goodbye, Before she could speak, she heard a gunshot. It happened in an instant for him, for her, and for me. I sat there with my eyes closed. I could see her son in his apartment, standing at the counter, the gun before him, the phone at his ears. I heard the sadness in his voice, the desperation, the finality. I heard the fear in hers. And in the moment he said goodbye and picked up the gun, I saw someone in the room. I heard another voice. And the other person came close and saying, "Don't. There's another way." But the pain was too deep, and his words had no effect. What happened next has stayed with me to this day. The stranger, who had spoken so quietly, so caringly, caught her son's body, held him, and then cradled him to the ground. And then he turned so that I could see his face. Somehow, it was every image of Jesus that I had ever seen, all at the same time. Now, since then, I have been asked many questions about life's challenges. Sometimes I have words that are helpful, and sometimes I do not. But what I've come to realize is that my presence, my willingness to listen and to simply be there, is what is important, and not my answers. I've also come to know in a deep and abiding way that this is what Jesus was doing on the road to Emmaus. He simply came alongside these two and walked with them, listening to their questionings, answering some, and being present in the midst of their grief. God is with us, with you and with me, in the highs and the lows, in the in-betweens of our lives. And whether you are elated, or whether you feel lost, abandoned, unsure, or unsettled, please listen and open yourself to hearing God's voice and experiencing God's presence. For surely, God is there, walking with you. Let us pray, this day using words written by Thomas Merton. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think that I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, will I trust you always, though I may seem to be lost in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen.
Our affirmation of faith this morning comes from the brief statement of faith found in the Glory to God hymnal on pages 37 and 38. Please repeat with me. In life and in death we belong to God, through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed, and blessing the children, healing the sick, and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, and delivering us from death to life eternal. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And now we come to a time in our service where we lift one another up in prayer. Join me. God of all times and all places, we are consumed with all that we have witnessed this week, the numbers of people who have died with the COVID-19 virus, the suffering brought on by the pandemic, the economic, physical, mental, spiritual, and psychological distress all over the world. We cannot turn away and we cannot turn off the anxiety we feel. We know you hear our voices and our prayers. We give thanks that you do not leave us alone, and as the risen Christ comes alongside us now, we pour out our hearts, unashamed to share how we feel. We rest in your sure presence as we share with you our thoughts and our worries, our hopes and our doubts. God of all time and places, remind us of how you rescued us from Egypt and sustained us in the wilderness, that you were with us in exile and made a way to bring us home, and that you can use good even when we intend it for evil. We give thanks that you do not leave us alone. As the risen Christ comes alongside us now, we rest in your resurrected presence. We listen for your living word. Give us your guidance in this trying time. Out of all times and all places, having walked with and listened to you, we recognize our Lord alive and showing us the way. You make all things possible, defeating evil, overcoming death, restoring us to right relationship with you and with one another. Send us, O God, to those places in deepest need of knowing that the creation is redeemed and that nothing can separate us from your love. Hear our voices, hear our shouts of praise as we proclaim, we have seen the Lord. He is risen indeed. We are not and will never be alone. God of all times and places, hear now the prayers that we lift up here this day for Cheryl Taylor's friend, Brooke Vestal, who's in hospital due to pregnancy complications. For Carl Travis, a pastor, former pastor at First Fort Worth, a friend and colleague for many of us, and for his family as he transitions into hospice care. for Billy's injury, as he has begun to make progress following a long battle with COVID-19, for his family and his friends as we begin to breathe again. And thanksgiving, O God, for all of those who have cared for him during this time. For comfort and safety for a man named John who frequents Kristen Hartwell's local 7-Eleven. And she believes that he is homeless. And between the virus and the spring storms, she is worried about him. Keep him safe in this time. For comfort and for healing for Emma Fielder's cousin, Bill and Carolyn Purfoy. He has complications after surgery, but is home. And she is still affected from a fall from last year. Be with them and keep them safe and bring them peace. For all who worry in this time, we ask peace. For those who care for others, we give thanks. For those who lead us, we ask wisdom and courage. For each of us, O God, we ask that you would be with us. Remind us that you walk with us each and every day. And God of all times and places, hear our prayers. Amen.
Please join me in saying the words Jesus taught his disciples, praying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
How does God's love abide in anybody who has the world's goods, and refuses to help a brother or sister in need? Remembering God's great love for the world, let us offer our lives to the Lord. We give you thanks, O God, for the bounty that you shower upon us. Use these, the offering of our lives and treasures, to feed the hungry, house the homeless, lift up the brokenhearted, and heal the sick, that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you.
as you walk the roads of your life. I want you to know that wherever you are, wherever you go, whether you're celebrating great accomplishments or tearfully grieving loss, whether you're in a crowd or all alone, the risen Christ walks with you, listening, holding you close, and caring for you. Take comfort in this. And now, as you go out from this time, go out in joy and return in peace. May the mountains and hillsides before you burst into song, and all the trees of the field clap their hands. Hallelujah. Amen. And the peace of Christ be with you.